Welcome to another webinar from the USME Center. Today's topic will be special economic zones. Before proceeding with today's topic, let me introduce the center. The USME Center is an EU Commission-funded project which helps USMEs prepare to do business in China. We provide different range of services, from advice to training and other supporting activities. We are implemented by a consortium of six partners, that you can see here on the screen: the China Britain Business Council, the China France Chamber of Commerce, Bencham, Eurochamp, the China Italy Chamber of Commerce, and the European Union Chamber of Commerce in China. Today's webinar is implemented by Bencham. Bencham is the most active Benelux business platform in China, and it counts over 250 members that are aspiring to grow further every day. If you want to know more about Bencham, please visit their website. I will now give the word to our expert, Maxime.
Thank you, Ilaria, and welcome everyone. Welcome to this webinar. My name is Maxime van het Klooster. I am from the Netherlands, and after my studies in business economics in both Netherlands and France, as well as my master in Netherlands and China, I moved to China, and I've been working in China for almost 5 years. I work here as a market entry consultant, so I help companies or I navigate their strategy into the Chinese market. With our company, we've helped over 130 companies for the last 7 years, and personally I've been responsible for over 20 companies with their successful market entry. As a quick introduction, we have both offices in Netherlands, in Shenzhen, and in Beijing. Now, today's topic is about special economic zones in China, and for that we have a small agenda. First, I'll talk about corporate structures in China, specifically foreign corporate structures. Then we define a special economic zone. What is it? We go into depth on the advantages of special economic zones, and we look at the opportunities for small medium enterprises, and we look at the market entry. Finally, we have a conclusion and some remarks. So first, the corporate structures. In China, you can have three corporate structures as a foreign entity. Firstly, you have a wholly foreign-owned entity, also called a WFOE. This is a separate legal entity from your foreign headquarters. It has the ability to also hire people to do marketing activities, but most importantly, to also do the invoicing locally in China. This is opposite of a representative office that is actually an extension of your foreign headquarters, and therefore it can only do the marketing and promotion of your activities in China. It cannot send invoices, it can only send invoices to the headquarters. So when you decide to register a WFOE or a rep office, you need to be very careful in choosing the right strategy and also choosing the right entity. Finally, there is a joint venture. This is again a separate legal entity, and it is, as any joint venture, a joint venture between two or more parties. This can be two Chinese, two foreign, or a foreign and a Chinese party. What is very important here is that the maximum share for every partner in the joint venture varies according to the industry and the business scope. For example, specifically for European SMEs, this can be important. A minority share is required in the following industries: in agricultural food processing, in the printing and publishing material industry, and performance agent companies. So if you're engaging in one of these industries, you have to be careful, because you can maximum obtain a 49% in the shares, and more importantly, a minority in the board of directors. On the other hand, other industries such as consulting or trading can have a majority share, and then you have, of course, a much bigger say in the strategy and the financial strategy of the joint venture. However, the Chinese government is lifting some of the minority share restrictions in order to make way for more foreign engagement within these specific industries. These are, for example, the financial industry, which has been changed in 2018. There is a big boost in the electric vehicle automotive section, which also can have a majority share of 51%, as well as shipbuilders. So if the Chinese government sees that they have a certain lack of knowledge, they are always willing to lift the minority or the majority restrictions and consequently have more opportunities for foreign SMEs in the Chinese market. This presentation, as introduced also by Ilaria before, is predominantly for SMEs because more than 99% of all foreign entities in China are actually small to medium enterprises. There are only a few international and multinationals, and the focus of this presentation is predominantly for the SMEs. On the right, you see the picture of the certificate of approval. This is something I would quickly like to elaborate upon, is although the process has been more structured and more clear of registering an entity, you still have to follow everything before you can actually obtain the certificate of approval. We have seen a distinct change from offline to online application processes, which can on the one hand speed up the process of application, but on the other hand also make it a little bit more vague because you need to fill it in on a Chinese website system. So on the one hand, the process of registering these three entities is faster. On the other hand, we do advise you to bring in some local support or local advice to make sure that you do it in the right way, especially if you register in a joint venture with a Chinese partner. This will bring you well prepared to the market. Having said that about Chinese and foreign entities, we now go into a special economic zone and what they actually are. So the special economic zone was established in the late 1970s. This was done by the central government as a new policy because they wanted to have more experience from foreign companies. They wanted to fuse this experience together with local entities and therefore increase the export and interaction with the outside world. Moreover, at that time, although many people have been lifted out of poverty nowadays, at that time there was still a very big poor population, and more interaction with the outside world would have led to an increase in disposable income and income in general for the Chinese population. So the Chinese government realized this and they looked at where can we get the experience the fastest. And that was by building growing awareness for opening up China. By that, they developed the local business while retaining more knowledge as well as stimulating the economy. This led to a huge increase in export and a huge increase in the amount of jobs. And that again led to an actual sort of SME wave for the Chinese entrepreneurs who were suddenly capable of having own companies and also earning their own money. On the other side, China still has and had at that time a planned economy. So one has to realize that a special economic zone is actually used as a trial. This meant that the restrictions that have been lifted for this specific zone were tested and closely monitored by the central government, after which, if they were successful, were taken outside the zone and implemented on a national level. This is still the case nowadays, nearly 40 years later. So, special economic zones, there is a whole variety of them. People often talk about free trade zones, they talk about export processing zones, warehousing regions, economic and technology development zones, high-tech zones. There are a lot of zones which can actually confuse someone. So the first thing someone has to realize when having interest or having a sparked interest in the Chinese economic zone is every zone has their own distinct key features. Because they were established as a trial, one has to realize that in a zone with automotive manufacturers, there is a lot of automotive activity. And every economic zone has a difference. I'll go later into depth for both Shenzhen and Hainan, which is a more recent policy, to show this with examples. Now, the initial key features, and they have changed a little bit, but not too much, is tax incentives for foreign entities, independence with regards to international trade activities, that could have been faster custom clearing zones or reduced taxes for assembling and import and export, special policies with regard to rules and regulations. One has to realize that such an economic zone often was under the scrutiny of the local government. Although the rules were established by the central government, the local government actually implemented everything, which also gave some room for negotiation and for changing slightly, bending, not breaking, of course. And coming to that, the local government has their own legislative authority. They had some freedom in deciding what was best and what was not good enough to implement or to stop. The goal of all of this, again, was to make sure that the right policies were expanded to mainland China. And that's something that you have to realize now. many of the success stories that we have seen in the past 2-3 decades have started in these special economic zones. They were here to be tested, and afterwards the successful ones, not the ones that were not successful, had central implementation. This led to the first phase end of the 70s. As you can see, that the cities where the special economic zones are predominantly in the east. This had two important reasons. On the one hand, you can see that they're all close to the ocean and the sea. That meant that they had ports and they had a faster outside connection with the world. For example, a lot of these cities already had been trading, but they didn't have special zones. On the other hand, in the 5-year plans, it was decided that the eastern region was first to be developed, and then over time, this wealth would move slowly and steadily to Western China. But the key focus was, as said before, manufacturing as well as exporting, and then starting in the east is a logical reason. And every city has their own key focus point. There are different policies, but the overall goal was economic stimulation. The first generation in Shanghai, Tianjin, Guangdong, and Fujian were used to develop the financial sector and drive economic growth in the region, while the next generation, still in the east, has more free trade zones that are marked by the establishment of moving to the interior of China, focusing on logistics, transportation, and international trade. One can say this was the internal Belt and Road Initiative of the 70s. Now, the second phase, which is happening nowadays, is a more moving towards the west. You can see that first it started a little bit more west, like Zhejiang, Liaoning, and Henan were established as commerce centers for the maritime and land services. Also, there was a more liberalization of international commodity trading, oil and petrochemicals. This all was mentioned in the 5-year plans. So the industries that were important to be developed were also the ones that had key focus with the special economic zones. Trade remained important with Hong Kong and Taiwan, and also Guangdong and Fujian towards the more European and North American region. Now, especially with the Belt and Road Initiative, more and more is happening to the west, and one can see a lot of train lines going from China into Central Asia and eventually also into Europe, where one of the first trains arrived a couple of weeks ago in Antwerp, actually. Finally, Hubei in Central East China, was developed as the transport link for the Yangtze River Economic Belt. Given the stated goal for the River Economic Belt is to develop the economy while protecting the environment, which is another key focus of the current 5-year plan, which is the 13th one. And it is no surprise that Hubei, next to it, has placed an emphasis on sustainable advanced manufacturing and new energy vehicle manufacturing. So you can see that next to the strategy of the special economic zones, the industry also become increasingly advanced and not only focusing on manufacturing anymore, but actually really focusing on high tech, on trading, and on the e/commerce industries. Okay, so how did it work in the beginning? The government said that the policy was designed to work in three steps. First, they decide where should we focus, where should we bring a new industry. So they develop a special economic zone with a central planning. Secondly is they wait for the foreign investment. Now, in the end of the 70s, initially this was not yet successful because people were very cautious with investing in the Chinese market. But over time, it became increasingly successful, especially in the early 80s. So it led to a surge of foreign investment, starting with Hong Kong, but afterwards also moving towards the Americas as well as Europe. Lastly, this led to a huge diversification and economic growth of the regions within the special economic zone and around it. So that meant that China could tap into a much larger source of capital, talent, technology, R&D activities, and some industrial parks contributed to 50 to 90% of the local GDP growth. After which the successful policies were implemented on a national level, and one can argue that because of these special economic zones and free trade zones, China has seen the development that we know it to have and had over the last four decades. One still has to say that even nowadays, more importantly, because the economy is growing at a less higher pace, that the current special economic zones are really here to test and boost the economic strength of China while trying out the new policies. I will come later to that with Hainan. So this was more a theoretical part. What are the advantages of special economic zones? We have learned now shortly about the history, but what can they do for foreign SMEs? So, as mentioned a few times, they're test centers for the future national policy, but there are also tax benefits for the European SMEs. The tax benefits are tax lenience based on profitability, and one has to note the word profitability. That means that there is a reduction of the income tax. If the company is not profitable, there will be no tax lenience. So one still has to make a very solid and sound business plan before investing and moving into a special economic zone. Because if you don't have a sound strategy, of course there is no benefit in terms of tax. For trading companies, as well as assembling companies, it's very important that there are fewer or no import and export taxes. This is very important for the companies that bring in the materials, assemble them, or put them in a local warehousing system, after which they either export them towards outside of mainland China or directly into mainland China. If they are exported into mainland China, one has to realize that there are still taxes due. One cannot avoid these, they still need to be paid. For an HR level, there is less or no social insurance tax for some European citizens. This includes Germany, Denmark, Finland, Switzerland, the Netherlands, and lastly Spain. This means that hiring foreigners in these special economic zones can give a distinct benefit because it reduces your HR cost and cost to company on salaries. The special customs monitoring system is very important for manufacturing and trading companies because there is a detailed customs clearance. It's only needed in a later stage. So if you bring in your products into a special economic zone, you don't directly need to go through a whole system. It's a fast track. And it afterwards, if you want to send them into mainland China, there is a faster procedures for custom clearances. One still has to realize that these products obviously need to comply with the Chinese rules and regulations of importing and exporting. If you fail to comply, then there will be consequences as well. So everything that is mentioned on this slide is given in and under the assumption that your company is compliant in China, that you pay the taxes even though you have to pay less taxes, and that you import and export the right products. For such a strategy, you need to be well prepared and make sure that you don't make mistakes there, because they can have financial disadvantages for the future. Another benefit is the reduced administrative and legal requirements of not only setting up a foreign entity like a rep office, UFE, or joint venture, but also during the administrative and legal period of its existence. So yes, one still has to do tax declarations and bookkeeping, but they're often easier, faster, and they bring less hassle. The easier conversion of renminbi to foreign currencies, lastly, is a very important one for often trading companies. When one wants to convert renminbis to foreign currencies, a two-step procedure is often needed. You need to go with the contract to the bank and the tax bureau to ask for permission from both in order to convert money. Only after the bank agrees and subsequently the tax bureau agrees, you can convert the money and send it abroad. If you have this process easier, maybe it will save taxes, but it will definitely save you effort in getting your money converted. Again, transfer pricing as well as paying the right taxes is of crucial importance here, but the procedure is less strict than we have seen recently in mainland China. So talking about the policy advantages, I would like to talk about Shenzhen and what happened there. Most of the people know that Shenzhen developed from a small fisherman's town into this huge not only financial but also tech hub in the last four decades. The development began with a special economic zone, and even though there are still a few special economic zones left in Shenzhen, among which the Shanghai economic zone, it all started with one zone. And it began with labor-intensive and low-tech assembling industries. But since the manufacturing shifted to other regions, including Dongguan and also west of Guangzhou and the Guangdong region in general, it has shifted to a more innovative and high-tech industries, which brings the big companies and the famous tech hubs that we know nowadays. This is a success story because they shifted their attention. They realized that in order to grow and make money, they needed to start with high labor-intensive industries. But over time, they focused on bringing more technology and tech companies into the zone and also afterwards into Shenzhen itself in order to make sure that this growth would be sustainable for the future. Beijing did the same in the Zhongguancun area and is also doing the same now in the Xiong'an Special Economic Zone south of Beijing, on which I will elaborate later. This success story proves the long-term vision of the Chinese central government, because they realized that in order to be competitive, they needed to make a change. So beyond the manufacturing, Shenzhen is a key logistics city for China. It's actually the fourth container port in the world and has over 50 foreign logistics and shipping companies, including multinationals like UPS, FedEx, and Carry Logistics, all registered there. Other multinational companies such as IBM and Walmart also have set up global or regional sourcing centers in Shenzhen, which actually have a large benefit for European SMEs, because they can lift on the growth of these multinationals and make sure that they can provide services and sell products locally. Because first and foremost, Shenzhen also has seen a huge boost in disposable income of its population. This is a case of the past. Now, for a case of the future, which has been more happening this year, is Hainan. This year, China announced that Hainan, also known as the China's Hawaii, would actually be a full special economic zone, which means that the entire island will be a special economic zone. Several policies have been announced to transform this into actually the country's largest special economic zone. In order to do this, they have put in a few year plans and they want to start really operationally in 2020. They will set up an investment fund to support the building of the free trade port in Hainan by 2025. And the president, Xi Jinping, actually announced that he would like to measure the growth also in leisure activities. This means that they will implement horse racing and sports lotteries to help boost the local economy. Effectively, this becomes a direct competition with Hong Kong and also Macau, which is known for its gambling. These measurements are encouraged to bring in the multinationals into Hainan. The focus for Hainan is currently still on the multinational level, but also for SMEs there are many, many opportunities, because these multinationals, they will boost the local economy and also boost the effectiveness and the efficiency of the island itself. So a very important difference between Shenzhen and actually any other special economic zone in China compared to Hainan is that there is a greater focus on the globalization and the consumerism. This means that within the special economic zone, people actually have disposable income and they can consume. So the products that are produced there can actually directly be sold within the special economic zone. And fusing the consumerism as well as the production into one successful region shows the outline of the Chinese government for the years to come. Because they think, and I actually also think, that this is the future. That you fuse both the consumer side as well as the manufacturing and assembling side together in one region where anyone can benefit. So rather than just establishing policies to promote trade, they really push companies to do both. Lastly, this break from the past has also a large impact on the SMEs within the region. they expect that these new zones bring business opportunities, but also bring the hungry consumers, not only from Hainan, but from all over China, to come there and spend their income. Lastly, I would like to go into the opportunities in the market entry, because the theoretical part of this sounds all very nice, and there are for sure opportunities. However, I would like to give some practical advice and fuse the information with the theory in order to make a successful entry for European SMEs in the Chinese market. Now, the potential areas of growth that we see is there are actually a few. One down below can see the Belt and Road Initiative, although this is often a sauce that is put on any dish. It's really important to realize that the Belt and Road Initiative promotes investment and also promotes trade and promotes relations with other countries. So it is important to keep the Belt and Road Initiative also included in the potential areas of growth and check if the industry in which you are engaging in is mentioned in there, because there might be opportunities for you. Now, as for the special economic zones, I would like to emphasize three regions in here. One is the previously mentioned Hainan. The other one is the Xiong'an New Area. This is a very important one, and it's again in the east of China. It's the third new area of national significance after Shenzhen and Shanghai, and it fuses actually Tianjin and Beijing input into one big zone. The area will become a new home for Beijing colleges, hospitals, business headquarters, and financial and public institutions. So a lot of these institutions move outside of the Beijing and Tianjin city center and will be focused in Xiong'an New Area. This shows sometimes how fast policies can be not only developed but also implemented in mainland China. Because there is money and there is a focus, in only a few years this will become the third biggest new area. Second one is the Greater Bay Area Initiative. The Greater Bay, in which we actually also have an office in Shenzhen, really shows that there is a perfect mix between manufacturing, tech, service companies, as well as the financial hub. This is in both Hong Kong, as well as Shenzhen, Dongguan, Foshan, and Guangzhou. So the Greater Bay Area Initiative, which actually the new Pearl River Delta, really can have large benefits for European SMEs. Of course, there are many, many more special economic zones in China, and everyone has their distinct advantage. So it's just very important that before you zoom in on one special economic zone, you actually look further. Maybe there are areas which you haven't seen yet or where you have not been. And even though you meet someone who represents a special economic zone, it's really important to make sure that you can see where your company would thrive most. Lastly, I really shortly like to go into doing business in China. We created six steps because we think that this is important when doing business in China. On the one hand, one can always see the opportunities in China, but it's getting increasingly difficult to tap into these opportunities. And this means that you need to create a strategy suitable for your company in order to penetrate the market. Now, this is very difficult to do because on the one hand, you have to stick close to your core, which is the key strategy which made you successful in Europe. But on the other hand, you need to localize that strategy in order to be successful in China. You can't move away in either direction too much. You have to find the perfect middle ground that leads you to thrive your company in China. That means that you need to create a new business plan for the Chinese market, because doing business in China is unlike doing business in any other country in the world. Not only there are key differences in the culture and language, also the way on how to do business is often very different. So, next to implementing your localized strategy, which is close to your core, know and understand the Chinese market in all its details. You should not only look at your own company and your own strategy, you should also look at the market. Who are my customers? And what are my competitors doing? Are my competitors mainland China? Or are they actually international companies? And as mentioned before in the corporate entities, am I actually allowed to do business in a majority joint venture or a WFAE. So you need to make sure that you know and understand the Chinese market. For that, a sound market research entry strategy is very important. Third thing is, you often do business here locally. That means that before you set up your entity here, you've flown to China a few times, you've sent your representatives to China. It's very important to train and manage your people specifically for China. It means that you make a business plan before you go together with your staff. You make sure that they understand how China culture works. And yes, there are things like giving your name card with two hands and making sure that you sit on the right side of the table, but there are also deep things that you need to understand, and they're often available online, and I advise you to download and have a look at them. Fourthly is, leave your Western culture at home. With Western culture, we often talk about how we as Europeans colonize the rest of the world. This is not always successful in China, and it's definitely not successful if you try to do business like that. You have to open yourself up to the other side of the table and make sure that you don't come in as with a colonizing mentality. But try to be open and try to think about their perspectives. In the end, it's best for everyone if there's a win-win situation. Take time to negotiate. This is often something which is underestimated by Western companies and Western business people. Time to negotiate means that if you visit a company, they often take time for first having dinner, first having a tour of the factory, or first actually not going to the factory at all. They try often to prolong your time. They do this for two reasons. One is, they want to see how you deal with it. And two is, it often gives you less time to visit other companies or suppliers that you are interested in. So if you have the time, take it. Make sure that you go to China for a week and schedule only one or two appointments that you can show the other party that you have time to negotiate. If you are at the negotiation phase of a contract, it often takes a very long time before every detail has been settled. And as you probably have read, a contract is not always a contract. There are still things that can be changed or altered afterwards. This is getting less and less in the Chinese market, where the rules and regulations and the compliance is increasingly important, but sometimes they will still try. So be prepared for this and don't be angry if it's the case. Listen to what you don't hear. Maybe you speak Chinese, maybe you don't. The good thing about going into meetings with translators is that the pace of the conversation is only half. If I talk in English to my business partner, my translator has to translate that for me. While she is telling this to my business partner, this actually means that I can look at his emotions. How does he reply to the things that she is translating for me? And on the other hand, I have the time to look at his face when he is saying something in Chinese and she's translating it to me afterwards. This goes into, listen to what you don't hear. It's very important to look at body language, to look at how someone is responding to what you say. Because in China, they often can say yes, but they're actually implying no. So listen to your feelings on how a conversation is going and make sure that you think about this before you actually go into one negotiation or two, even a business dinner. Because even though there is a lot of business dinners, there's a lot of lunches and happy time together, everything is business, and you should never ever forget that. The last thing that I say, and this also has to do with negotiation, as well as listening to what you don't hear, is always smile. If you're not happy with their offer, or you're not happy with how the conversation is going, don't show it. Always keep smiling and make sure that you have, you don't show how you are responding internally on this. Adaptability is the last part. Changing the rules and regulations of China is something that's been happened over the past few years. There have been a lot of changes for this. And make sure that your company is compliant before or during your business trip here in China and managing your company afterwards. And as a conclusion, I would like to say that study your strategy beforehand. Make sure you set up in the right special economic zone or free trade zone, but most importantly is, be well prepared and take the time to negotiate here while you are present. So I would like to thank you very much for your attention, and I'll be happy to be in touch with you if you have any questions regarding the presentation or about special economic zones in China. Thank you.
Thank you, Maxime, for sharing your knowledge. And if any of you has any question, you can get in contact with the center through the QR code on the screen.